So we have our strand of single-stranded DNA. We have the 5' end at this end, the 3' end at this end, which of course means that the new strand is going to be 5' on the other side and 3'. So the other side, of course, is going to be backward. We have an adenine, and we know that adenine goes with thymine. So let's, but wait a minute, but how is this going to work? We have our triphosphate. It's all energized and ready to go and ready to go to work. But I mean, I don't really see this one wants to go on this one, but that doesn't look like it's going to work. There's a little cheat that we're going to use here, which is also used in metabolism. And that is that there's a primer that is put on to start the whole program. Okay, now let's look at it. We've got guanine, and we have a cytosine that matches the base, and we've got a triphosphate. So this guy is energized for the reaction to be added to the base before it. The 5' with the phosphate attaches to the 3' on the previous one. Okay, that looks pretty good. We've got a thymine. The thymine wants an adenine, so we bring this guy in. The adenine looks like it'll fit. Two of the phosphates are cleaved off, providing the energy to make the attachment, and then this guy is hooked on 5' to 3'. So we've got two bases done. Well, good, we've got two more. Adenine goes to thymine down here. But wait a minute. Wait a minute. We need an energetic handle on the 3', and it's on the 5', which means this guy is not going to go on there. In DNA replication, the 5' end hooks to the 3' end, and it can't work the other way around. When looking at chemistry or science or maybe even anything, you really need to think about the energy. What is driving this process? Where does the energy come from? In the world of cellular biology, the big driver in the energy scene is ATP. ATP is like the primary energy source. It's like everything comes down to ATP. I think of enzymes as being like mechanical machines. They like have levers and things that push and things that pull and maybe pulleys and levers and things that shift. And ATP is like a tightly wound spring. And when it releases to ADP, it makes a physical change. And then when it makes a physical change, the enzyme makes a conformational change and is able to impact reactions that require energy. But it's done, I think it's fair to look at it kind of as a physical sort of thing. There's like a physical tension in the ATP. And when that's released, that physical release can be used somewhere else to do something. In the world of energy, the energy always comes from the sun. The sun comes down on plants, excites electrons. The electrons make like hydrogen gradients, and those hydrogen gradients, which are a form of energy, are used to make ATP. So ATP is like the primary energy source in the cell. One of the main uses for energy is that it's used to make glucose. So it takes, you know, bunches of ATP, but through a long, complex series of reactions, ATP, i.e. sunlight, is made into glucose, which is perhaps the primary actual storage unit of energy, which probably relates to the fact that sugar is fattening, because it's a big energy storage unit. The primary working energy source is the ATP itself. And then glucose is broken down to form ATP, which is then used for things actually in the cell. So what does all this have to do with DNA structure? ATP is adenosine triphosphate. ATP is one of our nucleotides. There's guanine triphosphate, which is seen in metabolism sometimes. There's cytosine triphosphate, thymine triphosphate, and uracil triphosphate. These guys are energized, ready to do reactions. Let's take a look at this. We have the sugar is here, of course. The phosphate is on the 5' end. The ATP, the phosphate is on the 5' end. So we have the 5', phosphate, phosphate, phosphate. The 3' end doesn't have anything on it. The deoxy is on the 2'. And then the base comes out here. So DNA replication. During DNA replication, recall, the chromosomes divide, the DNA is all duplicated.